Oh, hi, I'm the heretic. So how does libertarianism work? So how can we possibly prove the existence of property rights and defend them as foundational cores of our philosophy? They stem from first principles. So long as your argument derives itself from these axioms, then you don't actually need empirical evidence, because they could only possibly be wrong if the first principles are wrong. Now, these ideas stem from Shane Killian's video on the same topic, link in the description. First principles shouldn't need to be defended. Now that's quite a claim, that any argument could be beyond reproach. Well, let's take a look at these principles and see if you can refute them. Good luck. The basic, most foundational principle is also the foundational principle of all reason and logic, the principle of non-contradiction. This one's pretty intuitive. Something cannot contradict itself. An apple cannot also not be an apple. An apple cannot also be an orange, as what makes something an apple is mutually exclusive with what makes it an orange. Now, this is always true. This apple will continue to not be an orange, regardless of whether it is in New York City, see what I did there, Tokyo, or in orbit around Alpha Centauri. What I just described is called the consistency principle. If an argument fails on consistency, then it must be false. In a true dichotomy, where something is either an apple or an orange, all you have to do is falsify that it is an orange to prove that it's an apple. We know this is true because consistency is preferable, which we further know to be true because, well, consider the opposing statement. Consistency is not preferable. It contradicts itself, positing that it is consistently true that consistency is not preferable. Therefore, it is falsifiable, and the consistency is preferable statement must be correct. After all, the two are a true dichotomy. Only one of them could be correct. Therefore, the consistency principle. Now that we have our two first principles, let's apply them to interpersonal relationships. Burden of proof. Any action has two sides, a passive side and an active side. What if I told you the passive side had to justify their inaction? It couldn't be done. Think of all the things that you aren't doing right now. Driving an Abrams tank, skydiving, walking on the surface of the sun. The number of things you aren't doing right now is infinite. You couldn't possibly justify not doing everything. Therefore, the only consistent argument is that if you aren't doing anything, then you don't have to justify anything. Therefore, the burden of proof is always on the active side, not the passive side. That's not to make moral judgments about the active side always being wrong. That's absurd. All that burden of proof argues is that if a passive side is wrong, the burden of proof is on the active side to prove it. Now, force, by definition, is active. Therefore, those advocating for force have the burden of proof. If you're minding your own business, I have to justify any action I take against you or wish to have done to you. Let's use a random example. Say I want to take your money. Because everything I've described so far is absolutely logically consistent, I cannot avoid having to justify my actions without rejecting all of reason entirely by violating the consistency principle, even if I call myself a government. From this, we get that the initiation of force cannot be justified. Gee, this sounds familiar. Think about the statement in reverse. The initiation of force can be justified. If so, then what right do I have to complain about being punched in the face if I punched someone else in the face earlier? The only consistent application is civil aggression, where all initiation of force is always justified. It must therefore argue that those not aggressing, the passive side, are always in the wrong for not aggressing to satisfy the burden of proof. And there are many things you could do that aren't aggressive. Eating, sleeping, or even being the last person alive with nobody to aggress against. So the justification of the initiation of force cannot satisfy the consistency principle. Therefore, the initiation of force cannot be justified. This is the logical proof of the non-aggression principle, the basis for all libertarian thought and policy. You cannot refute the non-aggression principle without finding either a flaw in my chain of logic or refuting the law of non-contradiction. That is your only recourse to proving anything I said to be incorrect and refuting the foundation of libertarian thought. Now let's go to the fun stuff, property rights. Property rights are derived from self-ownership. If you don't own yourself, then who does? If you're paying attention, yes, that's slavery. But who gets to own slaves, and who is made to be a slave? To make these distinctions is to create an inconsistency in how slavery is applied. Nor can you say that nobody owns you. Ownership implies control of what happens to it. So if nobody owns you, anyone can do anything to you, including murdering you, and we've already talked about the problem with aggression. The only consistent answer is that you own yourself. Your body, mind, thoughts, and that which derives from them, as well as the right to defend yourself from aggressors. From self-ownership, we get private property. When you pick an apple, it is your thoughts and your body that brought the apple from the tree to your possession. Therefore, it belongs to you and you alone. If someone else has something you want, you can trade for it. You may transfer ownership of your apple to me to convince me to transfer my ownership of my orange to you. Alternatively, I agree to provide labor to your apple orchard for property in exchange. In fact, you can do this for any property you own, except one, yourself. What makes self-ownership a unique form of property is that you cannot separate you from yourself. No matter where you go, there you are. You may separate yourself from your apple or your kidney, but not yourself. Therefore, you cannot sell yourself into slavery. To do so is to create the inconsistencies I described earlier. Now, let's just suppose that I take your apples. In so doing, I am presuming ownership over your labor, the effort you put in to either get your apples or to acquire the resources to trade for it. By assuming ownership over a person's labor, I assume ownership over your person, making you my slave. Violating the consistency principle, therefore, through pure rationalist a priori logic, we can determine that the taking of legitimately owned property cannot be justified. Now, property may be transferred through compensation of damages, theft, or failure to meet obligations. Burden of proof puts property ownership as passive and the taking as active, therefore it must be justified. But in the absence of breach of mutually agreed upon contract or damages, the taking of legitimately owned property cannot be justified. Similarly, action made under duress is automatically invalid since it violates the non-aggression principle. So what does this mean? Property rights and the non-aggression principle can be proven by simply taking the first principles of logic and reason and applying them consistently in interpersonal relationships. With it, we can prove that all statist arguments are inherently inconsistent. The government's existence cannot be justified. Government is a territorial monopoly on the initiation of force. Taxation violates self-ownership and therefore the consistency principle. Legislation also violates self-ownership as it usurps self-ownership in dictating how you may or may not act. Therefore, it's violating the consistency principle once again. Make no mistake, taxes and legislation is slavery by another name. Taxation and legislation cannot exist independent of government. A government that does not tax or legislate is no government at all. To argue for government is to argue for the initiation of force and against self-ownership in the consistency principle. Therefore, to argue for government is to reject all science, logic, and reason. Want to prove me wrong? Here's what you don't do. Don't ask me who will build the roads. Don't tug at my heartstrings or argue that anarcho-capitalism isn't anarchism. Let me tell you exactly how to prove me wrong. Find the fault in my chain of logic. Do the links not fit together? Am I missing one? If you can find the break in this logic chain or prove the rule of non-contradiction to be false, I will cease to be a libertarian, but I'm not holding my breath. Questions, comments, critique? What other ways does statism violate first principles? Should we start a betting pool on how long until someone proves the rule of non-contradiction false? Like, share, and subscribe to become a heretic today.